pleasure to be here, especially with one of my oldest friends, a person who I fell in love with when I was 7 years old. So probably one of the first loves of my life, Muneeza, the person who introduced me to my first cigarette, who introduced me to my first Harold Pinter play at the Royal Court in London. And my parents refused to send me there because you had all nudity and nude scenes and all the rest of it. And Muneeza took us kids everywhere. So I have great memories of her. And let me just start by saying, you know, when I grew up in the 60s and 70s, there were all these publications which printed English short stories, English prose, English essays, poetry. We had Vision, which was published by Yunus Saeed in Karachi, Perspective, Pakistan Quarterly, the Illustrated Weekly of Pakistan, which was a copy of the Illustrated Weekly of India. I used to write all my poetry in these and get them published. And at a young age, I used to be able to tell colleagues in London that I'm a published poet, you know, at the age of 10, 11, 12, when they were still waiting to get their first poem published. And people like Anwar Muraj, Taufik Rafat, and the Mirror magazine, Zabel Nissa Hamidullah, all these are legends in their lifetime. And there was all this kind of activity, publication, quite apart from all the Urdu activity that was going on. And unfortunately, in the 80s, everything died. Everything took a sudden drop and died. There was no English publication in Pakistan, nothing certainly that carried fiction and short stories. And then, out of the gloom and doom of the Zia years, one person emerges. And that person is sitting on my right. And she, first of all, she puts together an anthology of young Pakistani writers and poets. And she puts together three anthologies of writings of young people. And Amina Sayed, I'm sure, is here, but it was so difficult for Oxford to even sell Pakistani fiction at that time that they had to bundle up Pakistani fiction all into one book in order to sell, 1,000 copies or 2,000 copies. And really, I mean, Muneeza, we owe an enormous debt of gratitude because she revives the entire tradition of Pakistani's writing in English. As I said, literally single-handedly. And many of us stopped writing poetry, stopped writing prose, etc. And she was a constant encouragement all along. So I'm very happy that she's here. Thank you. I'm very happy that she's here, and I'm very proud to be presenting her, not just as my first love, but also as somebody who's contributed to Pakistani English literature, and I'm sure what she has prepared for us is going to be very interesting. Take it away.
Well, thank you very much, Emma. That was kind of overwhelming. It takes me back a rather long time. We won't talk about age. Emma has given you a sort of brief overview of how much activity there was. But actually, in the Zia years, actually when Pakistani English literature kind of took off in the diaspora, because you suddenly started getting the foreign publishing houses. So in a way, the emphasis kind of moved from here westwards, and then it kind of came back as more writers grew here. What I'm going to talk about is actually the new writers in the new millennium, the post-2000 writers. Although there have been some really important work by established writers, including Amir Hussain, who's author of 7 story collections and a novella, and he wrote a lyrical first novel, Cloud Messenger, a wonderful portrait of exile, rich with literary influences. And then you have Abdullah Hussain, the distinguished Urdu writer who was interviewed earlier today. And he has published a wonderful English novel called Emigre Journeys, about poor working class Asian immigrants in Britain and the clash between first and second generations. And actually, it foreshadows work by people like Nadeem Aslam and the poetry of John Siddiq. But not all the new writers are young. You've got Jameel Ahmed, who was almost 80 when his first book, The Wandering Falcon, was published. He served as a civil servant in the tribal areas, and he used that to portray a timeless world prior to Pakistan's involvement in Afghanistan. He writes about the tribal areas. One of the questions that a British reviewer asked, a very pertinent question, it was, is this a novel or a collection of short stories? The question doesn't really matter in the reading of it. The child born in the first chapter appears often in the most tangential fashion in all the subsequent sections except one. A third minority rights. And so what you have is a murder, and the investigating officer who refuses to play along with the local strongman. So the man finds out that this man is in love with a Christian girl, and he then incites the town into a terrible act of mob violence as revenge against this man. The complicity of the community in acts of violence is very central to Nadeem Aslam's novels, including Maps for Lost Lovers, which is set in a working class neighborhood in Britain, very much similar to one that he grew up in. It's a nameless place. And in this, what I find so interesting about it is he creates Pakistan and England as if it's a one space. So you have people who turn up from Pakistan, they disappear to Pakistan, they intermarry, and there's this continual movement of people. And the center of the story is an honor killing, and what happens in Britain is, of course, they're wanted for the crime, and the community protects them by the silence, and then they come to Pakistan, and of course they boast of having done this great honor killing. And actually, you know, so it's a very interesting book, I think, and it's replete with literary references. And an example of the way he uses Pakistani literature is, for example, the one of the main characters is a woman, Korkab, the dead man's sister-in-law, and she's a cleric's daughter, and she just can't cope with England. And she can't understand her British-educated children. But in her part of town, in this all-Asian neighborhood, Pakistan is called Soni Dharti, and England is Dashte Tehnai, which, as you know, is of both famous songs. His next two novels focus on the conflict in Afghanistan. The Wasted Vigil, set in war-devastated country, where he set it in a villa. It's very much inspired by The English Patient by Michael Ondaatje. So he has a villa as the focal point. And the villa belongs to an English doctor whose wife was a doctor, Afghan, and she was killed by the Taliban. Daughter has disappeared, and different people come to this villa, and through their stories he tells the story of nations. You know, they're Russians, they're Afghans, they're British, and he kind of contemplates civilization against this war-torn land. And then the next one, the new one, is The Blind Man's Garden, which I haven't finished yet. And I've just read a review which is, describes it as one of the major novels of the decade. And it revolves around two idealistic brothers, Pakistani boys, who go to Afghanistan to try and help the victims of the American bombing. And of course, you know, they get caught up in a terrible kind of situation there. Pakistan's involvement with Afghanistan and the US-backed Mujahideen is central to Muhammad Hanif's political satire, Case of Exploding Mangoes, which, as you probably most of you know, it's framed by the mysterious aeroplane crash which killed Ziaul Haq. And he portrays the combination of Zia zealotry and American geopolitics with great wit, and of course asks, who killed Ziaul Haq? And it's a wonderful way he combines real people in the corridors of power, he fictionalizes them, of course, with his powerless fictional narrator, Ali Shigri, a PAF cadet, who is incarcerated and interrogated for a crime he hasn't committed. His next novel, Our Lady of Alice Bhatti, is set in an understaffed, disorganized Karachi hospital. which is also frequented by the police, because so many patients are either criminals or they've been shot up in the Karachi's violence. It's got a lot of black humor, and the central character, Alice Bhatti, is a conscientious young Christian nurse, but she's handicapped by, not because she's ugly, but because she's startlingly beautiful. And what happens is that she constantly attracts predatory males. It's a wonderful kind of reversal of her beauty supposed to symbolize. And she's marginalized further on account of her religion. And then she comes to be regarded as a miracle worker because she attends to hygiene, so her patients live instead of dying of sepsis. And the involvement with the Mujahideen, as you know, has led to the proliferations of arms and drugs. And you have writers like Kamala and Mohsin Hamid and Usma Aslam Khan, who actually grown up against this backdrop. And their novels portray the interconnectedness of nations and also class divide and violence. Aslam Khan's first novel, The Story of Noble Rot, juxtaposes the life of Malka, the wife of a poor carpenter, and the rich Mrs. Masood, the wife of Mr. Masood, owner of a carpet factory where Malika's sons work. Her next, Trespassing, alternates between Dia, a silk farmer's daughter, Danish, the boy she loves, and Salamat, a displaced young fisherman. And his livelihood has been destroyed by trawlers. So he ends up working in the bus addas of Karachi, where he comes in contact with the drug and Kalashnikov world. And that, in turn, he finds himself connected to these two rather privileged young people, Danish and Dia, in a rather unexpected way. Her third novel draws actually on a historical discovery of a rare fossil, a rare whale fossil, quite near here in northern Pakistan. And that fossil was called Pakicetus, and that there he is on her book cover. It's in her book she fictionalizes this, and the fossil is discovered by an eight-year-old girl, and her grandfather is a paleontologist. But he finds himself in Zia's regime, arrested for teaching the theory of evolution. So through these, through the book, she debates this kind of extremism with the intellectual dimensions of Islam. And it's got a lot of Sufi imagery like seeker and guide, blindness and light. And that's embodied by the fact that the main character, Amal, has a blind sister. Her new novel, Thinner Than Skin, is set against the wonderful landscapes of Gilgit and Buzanjar and Karan. And she interweaves this plot with folk tales and fairy tales. And then you have the gradual intrusion of modernity, and the main characters are actually expatriates, or complete foreigners to this land, although they've come in search of identity. And it leads actually to a terrible tragedy, their misunderstanding of the culture. So this changing face of Pakistan is the subject of Mohsin Hamid's new novel, How to Get Filthy Rich and Rising Asia. It's written in the form of a self-help book. So it lampoons that genre, and it tells the story of a nameless protagonist in a nameless country. But it's always addressed, who's always addressed as you. You must do this, and you know, then you do that, and then you must do this. And he learns to survive and escape from poverty and penury, and he acquires great wealth, but happiness and indeed the woman he loves eludes him. It makes a lot, his changing patterns of lifestyles also tell you a lot about the violence and brutality of our society. He's a very sophisticated writer, and his first novel, Moth Smoke, is framed by the fratricide of Dara Shikoh by the Emperor Aurangzeb. But the main plot is set against Pakistan's 1998 nuclear tests and the disintegrating friendship between the orphan Daru and his best friend Aurangzeb, Ozzy. Both move in a privileged world of parties and drugs, But Ozzy's father is corrupt and enormously rich. He can bribe his way through. He runs over a man and he blames the crime on his friend Daru, who is sacked from his job and slides into poverty. And his self-destruction comes to embody actually the derailment of society, which is increasingly divorced from reality. Ahmed's next novel is now a film. It consists of a monologue in which Cengiz, a Princeton-educated narrator, talks to an American stranger at a Lahore tea shop. It's a very intricate text with multi-layered innuendos. The interplay between the two characters is very clever, subtle, and ambiguous, and it remains debatable whether Cengiz is telling the truth or not, whether he's a terrorist or not, or whether the American is a CIA agent or not. And it follows his days in New York as a dynamic firm, Underwood Sampson, and his gradual disillusionment, confronted with the racial stereotyping after 9/11. In H.M. Naqvi's satirical first novel, Homeboy, a bright young Pakistani thinks of himself as a New Yorker. Although he loses his job in a bank for other reasons, he becomes a cab driver and he just loves the city. But he then finds himself regarded with prejudice and suspicion after the 9/11 bombing. And with a great sense of the absurd, he chronicles his misadventures. And the fact that his American name is Chuck, but his real name is Shahzad, gives you an idea of this kind of sly humor that he snips into this novel. Pakistan's engagement with the United States and the shaping of global history since World War II is the subject of Kamla's fifth novel, Bird Shadows. She tells of migration and changing identities in the modern world. Her main protagonist is a Japanese-born Hiroko. In 1945, during the bombing of Nagasaki, a German-born fiancé, Conrad, is killed, but she survives. And in Delhi, she is befriended by Conrad's sister, Elizabeth, the wife of a British official. Their Urdu teacher, Sajjad Ashraf, and Hiroko fall in love and marry. But partition sweeps the Ashrafs to Pakistan, where they and their son, a gifted linguist, are caught up in a chain of events in the 1990s, which takes Raza to war-torn Afghanistan and Hiroko to New York. Most of Kamla's, all of her four earlier novels are set in Karachi. In the first, In the City by the Sea, she tells of the struggle between military rule and democracy in a fictitious town similar to Karachi, and it's filtered through the story of an 11-year-old boy. His imaginary games as a knight provide a parallel universe to the battle for freedom and justice waged by his politician uncle. In her fourth novel, Broken Verses, the narrator Asmani has not been able to cope with the disappearance 13 years ago of Samina, her fiery mother, a fiery and fearless women's rights activist. And at the heart of the story is the brutal murder of the poet, the man Samina loved, and who wrote a famous poem inspired by the legend of Leila and Majnun. So she melds aspects of Urdu literature into her novels. And in Salt and Saffron, which is her second novel, she tells of a story of a family which is divided by partition and draws parallels with that, and a city, that is Karachi, which is so heavily stratified by class. And then in her third novel, In Cartography, she looks at another division, the loss of East Pakistan. And she links that fateful year, 1971, with Karachi's ethnic riots of the 1990s. Through the story of the narrator Rahim and her best friend Kareem, and the broken engagement of 1971 between Rahim's father and Kareem's Bengali mother. Actually, the 1971 war provides the backdrop to quite a lot of Pakistani English novels by new writers, including Sheherial Fazle's Invitation, in which the expatriate narrator returns to Karachi in 1970s and is looked after by his old family driver, a Bengali. But his search for his father's old friend, Brigadier Alamgir, leads him to the famous nightclubs and cabarets of Karachi. So he captures that lost ambience. But as the political crisis spirals, the worlds of the Brigadier and the Bengali driver collide. A writer who's little known in Pakistan, but well known in Britain now, is Rupa Farooqi. She's Lahore born, her mother was Bengali, and her father's Punjabi. He was N.A. Farooqi, one of the early Pakistani English writers. And she grew up in Britain. Her critically acclaimed novel, The Flying Man, is a wonderfully intricate story about a con man, a much married man, who lives under many aliases. Mikal, Mickey, Mehmet. He's a gambler, charmer, con man, liar. And he moves from country to country. And in her novels, probably because of this own background, her protagonists just seem to glide across national boundaries. So in her first novel, Bittersweet, Ricky, a wealthy Calcutta businessman, is entrapped into a marriage by an underage henna in Dhaka. In her second novel, she writes about a half-French, half-Bangladeshi family. In her third, The Way Looks at Me, she tells of three children, Asif, Leela, and Yasmin, brought up by a single parent, a British Asian mother, after the death of their Irish father. But when the mother dies, their Asif, in his early 20s, has to cope with Leela, who has a bipolar disorder, and Yasmin, who suffers from Asperger's syndrome. And her fourth novel, Half Life, links the South Asian diaspora in Britain and the Far East to tell of the Bangladeshi poet Hari Hassan and his old friend Anwar, a Punjabi military officer during the 1971 war. And so she uses this relationship to say volumes about intertwined family histories and of nations, and of these two particular nations. Of course, Moni Mohsin's first novel, The End of Innocence, is set against the backdrop of the 1971 war, but is set in rural Punjab and reclaims images of her childhood through the story of the 8-year-old Leela, the daughter of a landowner who's caught up inadvertently in events which lead to her maidservant's murder. But her real skill, I think, lies in that wonderful bilingual language that she used in her column, The Diary of a Social Butterfly, which is so popular, and which she has now developed into two novels, in fact, The Diary of a Social Butterfly and Tender Hooks. And finally, Musharraf Ali Farooqi, translator, novelist, he wrote this very boisterous first novel, Passion in the Time of Termites, revolving around an octogenarian man's obsession with a corpulent film star. But later he started writing very quiet, controlled prose. And in books like The Story of a Widow, he looks at social mores, and he tells of a widowed Mona who throws aside propriety and decorum to marry her flamboyant neighbor. But then she feels terribly guilty, so she puts up a photograph of her rather nasty ex-husband in her drawing room. And the photograph, of course, develops a life of its own. And his third novel is set shortly after partition in an unnamed subcontinental city. And it explores the changing lives and collapsing worlds of an aging pehlwan and a once beautiful wife. So that's just the tip of the iceberg, and there are lots more writers. Ones I would recommend are Surya Khan, Nafisa Haji, Azhar Abadi, and I haven't even touched on short fiction. Though I'd like to end by saying how excited I am to see Irshad Abdul Qadir's story collection, V. being launched here today, Clifton Road. I'm sure you all enjoyed reading it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. But I'll throw it open in a few minutes. Let me just ask you one or two questions, first of all. You know, if we look back at the explosion of Indian writing in English, starting with Salman Rushdie's Midnight's Children, and then, of course, you know, Amitabh Ghosh and, you know, dozens of writers in the 80s and 90s, there was absolutely nothing happening in Pakistan. And then we get, like, 10 years on or 15 years on, we get this Pakistani explosion. What do you account for this difference?
Well, I think, well, you know, the Indian writing, I think from the very first, we inherited only, there was only Ahmed Ali and Shah. You know, there was this contemporary writing or modern writing had started in the 30s. Most of them were Indians. And I mean, one has to face the fact that the Indians learned, many more Indians or Hindus had learned English much before we did. And I think this plays a role in this. But actually, at the time that Salman Rushdie and all this sudden burst of interest, there was a change of academic discourse in the West. So they started looking at writing from the Commonwealth and the colonies. And you had talented Indian writers, and they made this big splash. Pakistan was not actually nothing happening. Something was happening. You had, we had Zulfikar Ross in the 60s. His book, The Incredible Brazilian, was published in the 70s, and it was translated into 20 languages. And the Brazilians thought it was the most wonderful book. But in Pakistan at that time, we had this unfortunate discourse that you had to live here, you know, to be counted as Pakistani. And there were all these strange things, and they would say, Falana is deracinated because he lives abroad, and this kind of thing. But what you did at the time, I mean, shortly before Midnight's Children, you had Vapsi Sitwar publishing The Crow Eaters. You had books by people like Adam Zaminzad. You had Rukhsana Ahmed's novel. So the Pakistanis were publishing. So it was a kind of slow gestation that was taking place. And then suddenly you got a new generation which came up. To me, it just seems a follow-on, because Nadeem really, I mentioned him, Nadeem's first novel came out in 1993. He was only 24. And Kamra was also 1998. So you see this gradual happening in the 90s, and then in 2000 it suddenly takes off. I think possibly the geopolitics has some interest that, you know, Pakistan suddenly burst for unfortunate reasons into the... but I don't think that accounts entirely for the interest. I think there is just a genuine new talent, and it came later than the Indian one. But it was just, I think these things were just sort of follow-ups, one or the other. And possibly also because of this whole thing of the English medium education being more widespread there than it is here.
You don't mention Daniel Moeyedin at all, and I find him a beautiful...
Oh, he's terrific. Because I was talking about the novel, so I hadn't... Yes,
he's writing a novel now.
Yes, he's writing. I thought I had to cut down, because there's actually a huge amount of short fiction. Even Ahmed, who's here today, he's written seven books. No, Daniel's books are quite beautiful, and the skill there is, you know, how do you translate... I mean, this is a technical skill, and how do you translate that experience? It's all very well to say he writes like Chekhov, or reminiscent of Chekhov, but, you know, Chekhov was writing in Russian about Russia. When you write about Pakistan in English, you know, there's a whole technical issue involved, and to convey that, the tensions of rural life, the class structures, I think he's done it beautifully, and the imagery is beautiful. Yeah. So yes, I think Daniel's terrific.
And Mehmed Hanif's books have been, you know, very popular, and they are fantastic. And he's really single-handedly introduced satire and black humor into Pakistani literature. I mean, we are not a nation which really understands satire or black humor. Is that mine? Who's that? That's yours.
It's not mine. Someone's mobile is going. Please,
it's in your bag.
No, it's not. excuse me. I mean, that has happened to me, but not today. Anyway. Yes, we were talking about satire.
Yeah. I mean, is satire a logical experience for Pakistanis to read about?
Well,
you always think of British satire. You know, the British are the part. The Americans don't do satire. They can't do satire either. The British are the best at satire.
The British humor and American humor is quite different. Yeah. You know, and I'm not. You see, I'm a slight disadvantage here because I don't know enough about the Urdu satirical traditions. I don't know. I always felt that there was satire within the Urdu literary tradition.
Yeah.
I'm not sure. To what extent, I'm at a disadvantage here, to what extent it relates to Hanif's. But it's gone down very well. Once or twice, like I've given talks at medical colleges, and medical students don't often read that many novels in English and like, but they all read Hanif. Mm. He managed to speak. This is the other great thing about where people say, you know, sometimes, one of the issues of writing, a writer succeeds in speaking more directly to a Western audience. And we feel that this is not how we see the world. Although his view, I think, is perfectly valid. I think it's part of the whole. But Hanif managed to be funny to us and to be funny to the foreigner. And that's a great technique, it's a great skill. Yeah. He spoke very directly to the Pakistani audiences, I think.
The one thing I find about Mohsin Hamid is that he's a great writer, as you said. Technically, probably the most accomplished Pakistani writer. But his last two novels have all been devices. He's used a device.
Mm-hmm.
Now, by using a very clever device, by the way, I mean, which nobody else has thought of, what you do away with the emotionalism. You do away with the depth of character. You do away with the character development. And you're telling a story in a very flat kind of way. Now, it's a very clever device you've used, and people say, wow, you know, nobody's thought of this before. But, I mean, there's not a development of character. And I get disappointed by that.
Well,
his first novel does it. His last two novels don't do it.
I didn't feel that with Reluctant Fundamentals. I really liked that novel. I thought the whole skill of that novel was... were the ambiguities, were perhaps the kind of the silences where it kind of left it to your imagination. What exactly is going on here? You know, who is doing what? What? I rather liked that. Maybe it doesn't give that, it doesn't flesh it out, but then I recently read this book, A Sense of an Ending by Julian Barnes, which also is one of those things that when you get to the end, at least everybody else thinks the end is obvious, but when you read it, and I came up with a theory that was quite different, everybody said we didn't think of that one. It's a kind of game he invades. In a way, that's fundamental. It's a kind of game that he engages the reader in. You know, you fill in the blanks. I don't know, some people like it, some people don't. I don't have a problem with it.
Right. let me open this up to the audience. Do any of you have questions? Yeah, the gentleman in the front.
Muneeza, barring Kamila, who do you think is the most brilliant of these modern writers that you have mentioned? And don't try and escape it. Give me a direct answer.
Well, you know, I mean, the new lot is kind of clever, you know, and the. It's very difficult to come in because they're writing different things. You can't. Danyal, I think, is terrific. Mohsin. Despite Emma's reservation, I really like Mohsin's work. And Nadeem Aslam, I think, is very good. Particularly that Maps for Lost Lovers. The way he uses language, I think, is terrific. I find Uzma Aslam Khan also a very interesting writer.
All right, then, which is your favorite novel of all these? Barring, again, Kamila.
Wait, listen, I've got a very biased view as far as favorite novels. And the favorite novels are those written by members of my family. I'm now not going to go. You know, as far as anything written, even if it's not, yeah. I always find it so interesting. So,
I just want to ask one thing as a writer. I am just a reader and don't know much about the techniques of writing, and especially the novels. But I just want to know, is it because of a simple tilt of readership from Urdu language to English that all of a sudden all Urdu novel writers in English have become popular writers of Pakistan? And then maybe the second reason I want to know is that this is because of the resistive, tempting, contemporary issues on which these novels were written? Because
The first question is that the Urdu writers have become English. Is that the first question? Are the writers
English? Which makes it popular?
No, I didn't. What makes it the popular readership? The popular readership is of English.
Like when people don't discuss and maybe don't read. I don't know. The Khaso Khashak Zamane are the few other novels in Urdu which maybe discuss the same themes and the contemporary issues. But even as a very good Urdu reader, I would love to, you know, read all these novels, and their writers have become, all of a sudden, I would say, in late 90s and early 20s, popular writers, which is very important, because in this age of less readership, hamare yahan readership itni kam hai, log itna kam padhte hain ki jab wo angrezi ke tamam writers ko jante hain, unki books ke naam, aur jaise Muhammad Hanif ka aap zikr kar rahi thi, even medical students read them. Is it because of their intelligent selection of topics, ya ye ki Urdu mein ye sab kuch nahi likha ja raha? Kyunki mujhe lagta hai Urdu mein bhi likha ja raha hai, lekin shayad wo is tarah se nahi.
I am not sufficiently aware of the, you know, one of the problems is that people who write in English don't always have the choice. I don't have the choice of language, and I know that a lot of people from English medium schools don't have, because one language becomes your stronger language. The fact that these writers are being read now is because I think they've got a lot better than they were before. I mean, I think it's as simple as that. I think Urdu literature has a very long tradition of very good, or much longer, it came later than poetry, but it's a long tradition of very good Urdu short stories, Urdu novels. In English, it's been a long struggle because of the struggle of how do you write in English about the local experience. You know, to give a simple thing, when you say in an Urdu thing, if you say ladki ne jhukkar adab kiya, in that one sentence you have conveyed everything. But how on earth are you going to say she salaamed, she bowed, this meant this? So you've got to circumvent that complication of English. And I think it's only recently that the writers have, and the same goes to a large extent in Indian English writing, they have managed to tackle this. And so it has become very good.
I think Muneeza, the other real tragedy in Pakistan is that English literature is not translated into Urdu, and yes, vice versa. We used to have, if you remember, the National Book Foundation.
Yes.
We used to have all sorts of philanthropic efforts which did translation in the 60s and 70s. There is no translation facility now. There's no state or government that supports any kind of translation. Naturally, it would be wonderful if all these English novels were translated into Urdu, and likewise, you had English Urdu novels translated into English. And obviously you need subsidies for these, because there wouldn't be money-making concerns. You need some a national endowment set up by the government or by some rich industrialist who would finance this process. This happens in India to enormous extent.
Absolutely.
And there's, you know, all the regional languages are translated into other regional languages, into Hindi, into English, you know, etc. And then it goes the other way around. I mean, it's enormous progress. And it's not happening here.
Well, I mean, I can't speak for anyone else, only because I have privy to knowledge. I know that Kamla has been translated into Maharati. Yeah. You know, and I find that, but we do need this.
Yeah.
And,
Now,
I just wanted to ask a question about who writes in English, and the diaspora Pakistanis, of course, one group. And then when are you Salman Rushdie, is he Indian or is he British? Well, and I suppose if he says I'm Indian, he is Indian. And so, but I also would like to know what percentage would belong to the diaspora writing in English. And then, of course, there are other languages where the topic is English literature now, but I'm a Norwegian, and there is a good group of Pakistani Norwegians. They write in good Norwegian also, and some of those things could be translated, I'm sure, into English or into Urdu. Thank you.
Well, actually, a large proportion of the English language writers are diaspora. What actually happening now is that you've got a kind of movement. In the old days, you know, you couldn't get out of the country, you couldn't get into the country. It was so complicated. You know, there was a diaspora writer and there was a writer here. But now you find that people grow up here, they go to America or England or wherever, they come to, they get educated, sometimes they have jobs there, sometimes they come back, sometimes there's a continual movement, or sometimes they grow up in foreign countries because their parents were posted there, and then they come back to Pakistan and then they go abroad again. So it's the definition between diaspora and Pakistani is not as clear as it used to be. And that's one thing. This thing about who is Pakistan, like Salman Rushdie says he's Indian, and although his parents were in Pakistan, so he insists on being Indian, so that's okay. I'm often asked with my anthologies, and the person that everybody gets out after me is, why do you call Hanif Qureshi British, Pakistani when he's British born? Why do you call Zulfiqar Ghos Pakistani? Because he was born in Sialkot, then he grew up in Bombay, then he migrated to England, and then he migrated to America. What makes him Pakistani? You ask Zulfiqar Ghos this, he gets terribly upset. I mean, he says, I am Pakistani. He might have these other identities. We live in a world with multiple identities. Hanif Qureshi, he has a party, but he had his entire family here. He came here, there was a kind of interaction with Pakistan. And he doesn't have issues with it. All the work that I use of his is copyrighted and given permission by him. And so he doesn't have an issue with being called Pakistani. And he doesn't get incorporated in Indian English writing. So, I mean, I'm okay with these
models. No, I mean, if we see Muhammad Hanif wrote his book in London while working for the BBC. And then moved back to Karachi and wrote his second book in Karachi. Daniel Mohyuddin wrote his book on the farm in southern Punjab, and then migrated to the U.S. and then went back to the United States and is writing his second novel. So, I mean, exactly as you're saying, there is this incredible toing and froing, which was not possible when we were young.
No, not at all. No, it wasn't. And also the fact that people like Daniel is half American. So actually that duality is within his inheritance. He's half American. Yeah. And Sara Soleri is part Welsh. Yeah. And in a way, the writing is what is probably brings all these different elements of the writer together. And in a way, whether you're the child of a dual parents or you're the child of dual cultures, it is in a way it comes to the same thing.
Yeah. Who's next? Question at the back there, please. Can you stand up so they can see you? Yeah.
Hello? Yeah. My question is that, do you see Pakistani English fiction being able to transcend Pakistani subject matter? Because I've felt that they've found a niche for themselves within by exploiting like social norms in the Bangladesh plate and, you know, certain social conditions that are prevalent only in Pakistan. And do you think they'll move, fiction itself will move beyond that at a certain point?
Well, yes. In fact, actually, nowadays, because these are burning issues in our society, but actually, in an earlier generation, the poor Zulfiqar Ghos, who they insisted was not one of ours when he's written books about Brazil. Some of his books have absolutely no Pakistani characters. One of his novels has a German woman you know, and he discusses the divisions of East and West Berlin. He's written, I've forgotten the name, something about Bogart's strip. It's a witty thing. It's set in America. So Zulfikar Ross has been doing this for years, writing about America, writing about Brazil, writing about Germany, writing about Britain, and he set a novel in Pakistan. But what is interesting in these novels, when you say transcend Pakistan, you see part of your inheritance kind of seeps through. Sometimes you see bits of Pakistani society kind of floating into his Ross's novels, you know, the kind of social divide, the relationship between the landowner and the in South America. There's a lot of parallels with the subcontinent that come in. Adam Zaminzad is another chap. He has written, sadly no one has really read it much, the most beautiful novel is called My Friend Matt and Hen of the Whore. It's not about the red light area. It's about three children running away from famine in Africa. It is absolutely beautiful. He's written about South America. There's someone else who's just come to mind who's written about, I've forgotten, but Pakistani writers have been doing this actually for quite a long time.
Tawfiq Rafat, Pakistan's greatest poet writing in English, once told me that our landscape will always live inside you, no matter where you
absolutely.
Go. If you go to England, you go anywhere abroad, you will always compare the most beautiful landscape you will see abroad with Pakistan's landscape. Because you grew up in this landscape, and this landscape has meant to... And if you read people like Ghosh and all who are writing about foreign countries and foreign places, you still get this sense that he's writing about Pakistan's landscape, you know. So, of course, I think you're absolutely right. This, where you were born and what you grew up in, and it stays with you. Yeah, anyone else? Yeah.
My question is that since you've just highlighted that most of the writers writing in English have either lived in the West or they have some sort of a support system which enables them to gain their works to gain recognition in the West. What about those writers who have been born and bred in Pakistan, they've lived here, they've had absolutely no exposure to the West? Don't you think it becomes more difficult for them to, garner attention towards their work?
Well, I don't actually think so. I think it's kind of pretty difficult to garner attention as a writer, full stop. I think it's in the West, I mean, what has actually really been a great support to the Pakistani writer, ironically, is the fact that the large number of them are all published in India. So someone wrote an Indian, a journalist wrote an article written in Pakistan, published in India. But this is true. So a lot of novels that do not have that much of an appeal to a Western audience or a Western writer, the Indians pick them up very fast. Because they're next door. They can pick up the nuances. And one of the problems here has been that there has not been enough fiction being published in English, because we haven't developed as yet. Because I think Pakistani English fiction, coming on the scale it is, and the fact that so many young writers are wanting to do it. You know, I mean, when I have poor Kamla, I keep using her as an example, but we were sitting in the hairdresser, she was a little girl, and someone said to her, "What are you going to do, Beta?" And she said, "I want to be a writer." And the woman said, "But there's no money in that." And so you know, you've got damper, but now with all these writers coming up, you know, someone might think twice, they might think you might make the grade. But our publishing industry has yet to keep a pace. And what a lot of locally published books of English fiction do not have is qualified editorial support. You know, every writer needs editorial support, and often you see very talented work, and it just needs to have a few things knocked out. And for the writer to also have that, and that is the real problem, I think. It's not easy to get support as a writer. It's not, it's just because they're happening abroad. It is I do believe it has got something to do with talent. I know that in the old days when Indian English writing was so popular.
And he wasn't really acknowledged much by Western publishers. He changed his name to Prima Marquez, and he got published.
Did he change his name to?
Prima Marquez, a partially Indian Latin American name. And he got published abroad by Penguin. So it's to be very honest, Pakistani writers who live here, they find it difficult to market their work and get published.
No,
I don't know.
Listen, let me tell you. I mean,
I don't believe this.
My agents in England and America are looking for the next Salman Rushdie in Pakistan and in India. Or they're looking for the next Daniel Moeyuddin or whatever it is. There's an enormous interest in new literature coming out of South Asia. And, you know, I mean, if you're a good writer, if the book is good and it's of a quality, it will be seen by agents abroad. This is not the 20 years ago. This was not the case. Nobody would even think about publishing a Desi writer. Nobody. And I think that has really changed.
It has changed. What, Sunny? Your first. What? Hey, listen, because the whole thing, you've had exposure to the West, if you've had no exposure...
So that is the reason, I think.
But that is the whole thing about English. The English brings you exposure to the West, full stop. So very few people...
Let us, Muneeza, pause for a second and think of somebody who's never been abroad, but has schooled in grammar or one of the HSN college or something like that. Somebody who's well acquainted with English and English grammar.
Well, I think...
Have they been anything?
Did Taufik have great exposure to Britain? I don't think Taufik
Rahman. Not at all. Taufik read English poetry sitting in cell court. He didn't, you know. Look. Half of these novels that we've discussed, that Muneeza is very kindly, half of these novels are about angst, about identity crises, about, you know. Now, obviously, this identity crisis has grown up because you've been, you know, West, East, torn between two lands, two cultures, blah, blah, blah. A lot of this is about identity. Now, we ourselves are going through an identity crisis, which is why I think these novels are so relevant to our own crisis, internally inside Pakistan. We are going through an identity crisis. They are going through an identity crisis. And we can appreciate their novels because we are undergoing the same process. So, I mean, yeah, we will reach a stage, maybe 10, 15 years, we stabilize, etc. We'll have a different type of novel. We'll have a more stable, secure love story about, you know, the set in the heartland of Punjab or something, which will become an international bestseller, like Dr. Zhivago. You know, we'll have something like that. But at this particular stage, our stories are about angst, identity crisis, who we are, where we are, what we are, etc. Yeah.
No, I was just saying,
probably, you're quite right. He went and lived in Canada, but I don't know how much he'd had by the time he was wrote his first novel. I'll tell you this thing about Urdu. I'll tell you something very interesting. I interviewed Musharraf a long time ago, and he's Urdu speaking. His first language was Urdu. He translated the Dastan of Amir Hamza, which I think is an amazing feat. But he grew up reading these books, and I said to him, why did you switch? He said, well, you know, I was just an avid reader. And I had read everything I could in Urdu by the time I was such and such an age, and so I started reading English. And he says that there was much more available for him to read in English. And gradually, English became the stronger of his two languages as a creative thing. But I don't know whether it's the stronger of two languages because he does these wonderful translations. And he then went to Canada, but his basic roots were here. And his involvement in literature and involvement in writing began here. So, yes.
Just an observation, I might be wrong, but according to what Sir just said, Bapsi Sidhu
Yes, absolutely. Yes, Babsi also grew up in Lahore, quite right. But she had a strong Western influence in the family. It's not as if...
Well, I think we have to end this now. And I just like to thank Muneeza. She's lived up to her past, introducing all of us to this wonderful recent history and successful history of ours. I hope, you know, our novelists flourish and do well and become internationally acclaimed and address the kinds of problems that we are really facing here at home, not just identity, but all these other problems that we are faced with. Thank you very much indeed, Muneeza.
Thank you. Thank you.